speak Georgian. Or if I have to this debate with French people in French, I know French, but of course it will always win. That's not fair. So somehow the idea is that a public sphere is only possible if we share a common language. Moreover, a common language is thought to be a presupposition or precondition of something like a collective identity, of something as a nation. And democracy, if democracy has to do something with self-rule, self-governing, presupposes a self. And that self, you know, the demos, who is it, is what we call collective identity, such a self that rules itself, can only emerge, that's the idea, if we somehow are a cultural unity, a lingual unity, that we share the same historical experiences, that we are all in the same boat, that the future is, we have to build together, etc., etc. Well, Wittig says, there is not, and certainly in those days that was correct. I hesitate to say that it's based on that, but certainly in those days there was no European, developed European civil society. There was not, and still is not, there is not still a developed European public sphere debate. There are some papers and European Voices Weekly, some papers which, of course, inform you about European politics, European policy making, but that's only for a very small elite and professors who are interested in European studies, but no common, really living European transnational or supranational debate. There's no common language. German may be the biggest language, but it's certainly not a majority language in Europe. And last but not least, the real world thing, there is no European collective identity, there's no European demos. There is no European self that can rule itself. So the critique says, under these conditions, strengthening the European Parliament makes things only worse. So, conservative Democrats say, don't strengthen the European Parliament, because given these conditions, things will only become worse. Now, as I said, they were Democrats, and they also believed that there was something wrong with European democracy. So what we see up and against the parliamentary remedy, what I call the remedy by limitation. Three types of arguments. The first, typically neoliberal. People who said everything went well as long as we cooperated only in the economic level. The problem is, in economic cooperation you can defend by simple economic criteria of efficiency, etc. The moment you also start to cooperate in a more political level, well, politics you cannot simply sell by economic criteria of efficiency. Now, when you start doing that, a legitimacy problem emerges. Now the whole problem of democratic deficit emerges. So, what should we do? Stick to economic cooperation and economic cooperation alone. Don't go into politics, political cooperation, and then everything will be much better. Less radical people, like for example Fritz Charles. Now, let's be honest, the nation state is still the center of democratics. We should therefore defend the autonomy of the nation state, meaning no majority voting, no qualified majority voting, back to a general veto, then we can control our own ministers, our government, etc., etc. And Sharp also said, European lawmaking, so to say, should stick to very general framework laws and leave all the details, implementation, everything to the member states. So, defend the rock prestige of democracy, that's nation state. The last one came from Gian Domenico Maggiore. It's an interesting one, quite different. Maggiore says, look here, everywhere, also in member states, we're dealing with different types of policies. We deal, for example, with regulatory politics and with redistributive politics. Now, redistributive politics, name is already clear. is politics, and politics has to do with the redistribution of wealth in a society. Clearly all social welfare states are heavily doing redistributive politics. And a typical example would be social security. If you drop out to working force, you get unemployed, there is money for you so that you at least will survive materially. The money has to come from somewhere. Well, some people have too much, so you redistribute it. Now the problem is here that this is a zero gain situation. Whatever someone gains is lost by someone else. If I'm rich, I have to give, and if I'm poor, I get it. So, because it's a zero gain situation, you'll never get a compromise. So you cannot make policies in this field based on consensus or compromise. So, if you have to decide, then still, you need a system of deciding which can cut the knot. And it has to be very strongly embedded in normatively acceptable institutions, in legitimate institutions. Typically, majoritarian voting is one way to do it. If we can find a compromise, you say 50 plus, yes or no, so we cut the knot. And majority voting, and that, in a strong democratic tradition, will do the trick. So, whenever it's about redistributive politics, you need a democratic system, a strong democratic system. But there's also regulatory politics. The basic example of regulatory politics is of course, for example, regulating trade. You can choose to have right lane or left lane driving. Doesn't matter. But it matters that you choose something. Everyone is better off if it's decided to drive left lane or right lane. This is a win-win situation. Whether you take right or left doesn't matter that much. Do I go voting for right or left lane driving? No, of course not. Am I going to vote for standardization of electricity in 220 volts? Could also be 230, 180. No, of course not. I leave that to specialists. Everyone is better off if it's regulated. Without regulation, it's really bad. Because then we cannot drive anymore. So, regulatory politics, you can leave to specialists, to perhaps technocrats, whatever you want to call it. For that, you don't really need a full-blown democracy. Well said, Bajorman. And he has always said that. In fact, European politics is only regulatory politics. So what's the matter? You don't need a strong democracy as long as it's regulatory politics and as long as Europe sticks to regulatory politics and doesn't go into redistributive politics. So, as you would say, there's not a real problem. Now, of course, again, here you'll see a lot of critique. The first neoliberal idea of let's go back to economics and economics alone. Well, the counter-argument is simple that it's exactly the success of economic integration that has forced the member states to also start political cooperation. I'll give you two examples, the very simple ones as well. If you have internal market, the idea is that there's a level playing field. All companies, so to say, should have the same chance. Now, there are some negative externalities in the way we produce and in the capitalist system. For example, threats of environmental chemicals. Now, imagine that in Netherlands, Germany, Sweden, we are accustomed to a high level of environmental regulation, and we want that. This is a general good that our government system has to provide us. But it means cost. If you say you may only produce if you have kind of filters, or you have to adapt to all kind of environmental regulations, this is of course costly for the economy. If Greece says, well, it's not so urgent for us environmental regulation, we don't do it, then of course Greek companies can produce much easier, have less costs, and this would mean distortion of the level playing field. So, if you want to have a level playing field, and there are negative externalities you have to do something about, for example, environmental problems, You have to start cooperating also in that field.